It gives me great pleasure to introduce you to the, for the very first time, the new U.S. Chief Technology Officer and Assistant to the President, my friend Megan Smith. Welcome, Megan.
It's so awesome to see you guys and to be here. It's exciting. I love Grace Hopper celebration, and I love the chance to be with all of you guys. It's interesting because I think Nancy Pelosi, when she reflected on becoming the first woman as speaker, she felt like all of us, all of the women came in the room with her. And I feel like as the new Chief Technology Officer for the United States, you know, all of you are coming in the room with me. It's exciting. It's an honor to serve the president and to serve our country. And so when I was asked, I jumped at the opportunity, and I'm really looking forward to what we can do. I'm going to talk a little bit about that, but I first just want to reflect on this culture shift. It's been a long time coming. I remember in the president's speech when he said from Seneca Falls to Selma to Stonewall, and reflecting on Seneca Falls and the list of the Declaration of Sentiments and the things that Elizabeth Cady Stanton complained and talked about that were so unfair, and we just had the Girl Rising amazing movement photos up here. We're on a path that's unstoppable, and you guys and we the techies are a big part of that. I think that one of the big things that we just have to keep doing is keep demanding and pushing. You know, that's how all change happens. And yes, and so we need to do that. We really have a culture problem in technology. It's not the original heritage. Walter Isaacson's new book is out this week, and it starts with Ada Lovelace, first chapter, our first chapter as computer science. And it goes on and talks about many of the different pioneers, the ENIAC women and others. And one of my favorite things about the book is it's focused on teams. Sometimes there's an obsession with the founder. And in fact, often teams are the ones that do such extraordinary things. And often, if you look at the old historic photos, there we are, the women. There we are, the people of color. But we weren't included in the names that were listed in who did the project. In fact, Kathy Kleiman, who created the new ENIAC series, the computers, that we're going to play the trailer of tonight in the film festival, the women weren't even invited to the launch dinner, and they're our first programmers in America, in modern America. So we're getting our history back, which is awesome. And I think the critical thing is not only our work on K-12 and our incredible work, Maria Clawe is in the house at the university level, but really our culture in the professional level and demanding what I see as a death by a thousand cuts from all the unconscious bias that lives around us as we wake up. And I'm hopeful because I think that the tech industry could move the fastest of all the industries. That's how we roll, and that's what we could do. If we see the problem, we can debug it, and I encourage us to do that. So let me switch gears to my new role. It's incredible that the actual job of the CTO, it's an architectural job. It's not running the engineering of the government, but it's to advise the president and his team on how to unleash the power of technology, data, and innovation on behalf of the nation. And so we are a small team that lives within the Office of Science, Technology, and Policy. I report to the president, as does Dr. John Holdren, the amazing science advisor to the president. And so we're embedded with our science, our security technologies, our energy technologies, our other innovation teams, about 70 people in the whole OSTP team there, and we work together. I'm focused on three things. One is we have a history. I'm the third person in this role. The president started this role on his first day. He's very focused on tech. And I might invoke something from history for you guys to think about, which is technology and this country have a great relationship. It's been part of our advancement forever. In fact, George Washington, before he was president, before the country was founded, started the Army Corps of Engineers. And so we have a long history of being at this table. One of the areas we're working on is, of course, tech policy. things like spectrum and broadband, privacy, intellectual property, net neutrality, all those works, and having the engineering teams at the table together with those general discussions. One of the things I'm interested in especially advancing is what I call connectivity deserts, you know, like food deserts. Where do people not have access? Lots of work there. Anyone in the House who wants to help on that, I'd love to hear from you. The second area is about this government itself. How are we going to be better at delivering our services? The American people expect to interact with us digitally and mobily, and we need all of you, we need all of us. Mikey Dickerson is here, who started the US Digital Services in the office of the CIO, this whole idea of smarter IT. And one of the ideas we have there is not only the digital core, those of us who are putting 100% of our time into our roles at government, but also a digital reserves. You can come for 2 weeks, you can come for 6 months, and many of the companies in Silicon Valley and other places are signing up to let their people doing that. We already have people, please come join us. And then the Digital Council, which is advisors all around, of which all of you are members. The third area for me is the American people. Today the president, later today, will be in Los Angeles in this incredible tech incubator talking about some of the new research that's out on millennials and the jobs and innovation nation that we are. I reflect on kind of two Americas. There's the America we live in, which is so exciting and vibrant, and then there's America that people are kind of stuck in where they can't see that opportunity, they're not connected. And my favorite example of that is out of the Recovery Act, some of the broadband, a shift there, the broadband that came to some regions that really are suffering, a place in Arkansas where SamaSource showed up. And so several people are taking short classes at community college, and this is a group of people who are making maybe $10,000 or $12,000 a year are now able to add in TaskRabbit and Elance and other things because they're learning how to use the web to make more money and adding $2,000, $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 more a year to their salary. Substantial difference. So all kinds of things that we can do there to get the American people in. To me, that's a barn raising. It's a movement, and it takes all of us. We're diaspora from almost every part of this nation and every part of this world. I'll end with an image for you of something I got to do earlier this year. My friend Omoju is here in the audience. We were in Nigeria, and I was with Malala Yousafzai and her father, and we were in Nigeria to meet with the girls' parents of the girls who were stolen by Boko Haram. And Ziadine reflected, sitting next to Malala, he said, you know, the one thing she and her mother and I said was, thank God she wasn't taken. And it's such an image, he started crying. And I think of, you know, you don't really connect technology to that moment, but really it's an area of total connectivity deserts and interconnection, and all the people who are living in that northern part of Nigeria are not connected to this innovation space, and people are able to do terrible things to them. So let's work together to bring everyone along and to bring the technology that we know how to solve problems with, like George Washington asked, like this president hopes for. And I'll end there and say thank you very much.